Hello students, welcome back to our channel Physics Gallery. Asha Binu and this is your Asha ma'am coming with the new chapter semiconductor and semiconductor devices. Okay, so a very good morning to all of my dear students. Hoping all of you are doing very well with your studies. Always studying. Yeah ma'am, we have other duties also. Okay, yeah, I know. So today we are going to our new chapter, a very very easy chapter, interesting chapter, semiconductor. Okay, and so let us start. So before this chapter we have discussed about our atoms, and in atom, Bohr's atom model we have discussed in detail. There we have studied, Bohr had told us each electron in atom of an element possesses a definite amount of energy. Each electron in an atom possesses a definite amount of energy. And that energy is given by the equation E is equal to minus m z square e raised to 4 by epsilon 0 square n square h square. Taking the constants together, we have written it as E is equal to minus 13.6 electron volt Z square by N square. Okay. So, every electron possesses a definite amount of energy. If you take different elements, take the atomic number of that element. If you take different shells, take the number of that shell. Even though each electron possesses a definite amount of energy according to Bohr's atom model. Okay. That we have studied in our chapter called as the atoms. But in this chapter, we have to discuss about the solids. We have to discuss about the solids. Okay. Where the atoms are, suppose we have taken a solid piece. What is the speciality of solid? There the atoms are closely and tightly packed. Each atom is closely and tightly packed inside the solid. Okay. As a result of this arrangement of the atoms or molecules of the solid, what happens? The Bohr's concept of definite amount of energy inside a shell where the electrons reside cannot be taken here. Why? Because when atoms are closely packed like this, the influence of other atoms occur. If we consider one of the atoms like this, it has a nucleus, it has its own electronic shells and etc., valence shell, etc. But it is influenced by the other electrons in the other atoms. So what happens? The definite amount of energy for an electron in an orbit is valid only for an isolated atom. But for atoms inside the solid, we cannot say each electron possesses a definite amount of energy. Why? Because of the influence of other atoms. If we take one atom, for example, I have taken the nucleus of one atom. This is the first shell. This is the second shell. Suppose this is the valence shell. Sorry. This is a valence shell. Okay. Here there are some electrons. Here 8 electrons are present. Here 2 electrons are present. Okay. These electrons possess a definite amount of energy according to Bohr's atom model. But inside this solid, what happens? This is the valence shell of the neighboring atom. There are also valence electrons present. Here also the neighboring valence shell. Here is also neighboring valence shell. Here is also neighboring valence shell. So whether the electrons in the valence shell of our atom, which we have taken here, okay, remains constant? No. Repulsion between electrons and electrons make this electron to move inward. At the same time, the nucleus of the neighboring atom attracts the valence electrons, so it tries to move towards the nucleus of the neighboring atom, as a result of which We can say the electrons never possess a definite amount of energy inside a solid. Okay, they possess, they can move to this range, they can move to this range. So that we can say they possess a range of energy. This is the, this line represents the definite energy level. But now we have to say the electron may see in here, the electron may see in here, the electron may see in here, 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 etc. Due to the influence of the neighboring atoms, what happens? The electrons in each atom inside a solid possess a range of energy. Clear? Similarly, this second shell also possesses, that electrons also possess a range of energy due to the influence of other electrons, other atoms. Okay, the first shell also possesses a range of energy, but that range is very small when compared to the valence shell, because the first shell is the nearest shell to that of the nucleus. Okay, so we can see inside a solid, an electron in an atom possesses a range of energy, and that range of energy possessed by an electron in an atom inside a solid is called as energy band. Clear? So the first term which we have to discuss in the semiconductor is the energy band of electrons. Okay, so what is energy band? What is energy band? Energy band, it is the range of energy, the range of energy possessed by an electron in an atom inside a solid is called as energy band. So what is energy band? The range of energy possessed by an electron in an atom inside a solid. Okay, if we consider one of the atom from this solid, it has its own nucleus. Suppose this is the first shell, this is the second shell, and this is the third shell, which we are taking as the valence shell. Suppose the third shell is the valence shell. Okay, outermost electrons are present there. Okay, here there are two electrons, and the two electrons possess a range of energy like this. They can move like this, a range of energy like this. Not the definite amount of energy. They can possess a range of energy like this. When we go to the second shell electrons, their range some more increases. So suppose this line, the zigzag line which I am going to represent, which I am representing, is just a representation of the energy. Okay, clear? These electrons may move from this region to this region. And suppose this is the valence shell, and what about the energy range of the valence shell? Maximum. Why? Because it is influenced maximum by the neighboring. Okay, so these electrons may be seen here. This is just a representation, not take the knots of this world. You have not have to draw that figure. Okay, so we can say an electron in the valence shell can be seen here, can possess this much energy, this much energy. So this is the range of energy possessed by the valence shell electron. This is the range of energy possessed by the second shell electron. And this is the range of energy possessed by the first shell electron. If so, the range of energy possessed by the first shell electrons is called as the first energy band. The range of energy possessed by the second shell electrons is called as the second energy band. And the range of energy possessed by the valence shell electrons is called as the valence band. Okay. So the energy band of first electrons, the first shell electrons, the range of energy possessed by the first shell electrons is called as the first energy band. That by the second shell electrons is called as the second energy band, and that by the valence electrons is called as the valence band. So the first band, very important band, is our valence band. So what is valence band? The range of energy possessed by the valence shell electrons is called as the valence band. Clear? Okay. And sometimes In some solid, what happens? Electrons in the valence shell will get sufficient energy to break the force of attraction with that of the nucleus. There is a force of attraction, electrostatic force of attraction between the electron and the nucleus. Sometimes in some solids, what happens? Electrons in the valence shell get sufficient energy to break this force of attraction provided by the nucleus. Then what happens? Then their electrons becomes free. They are not bonded now. They are free. They are free from the bond of the nucleus. Okay. And such electrons will escape out from this valence shell and becomes ready to conduct. And such free electrons, now the electrons are called as the free electrons. Such free electrons are called as the conduction electrons. And the energy range, the range of energy possessed by these free electrons, conduction electrons, is greater than that of the valence band electrons. Okay, and hence that range of energy possessed by the free electrons is called as the conduction band. That is called as the conduction band. So what is conduction band? If the electrons in the valence shell get sufficient energy to break the force of attraction provided by the nucleus, then what happens? Such electrons escape out from the valence shell, okay, becomes free. Now the electrons are called as the free electrons, and the range of energy possessed by the free electrons which are ready to conduct is called as the conduction band. Okay, so the higher band is the conduction band. So we can say, suppose this is the conduction band. This is our conduction. This is just a representation, okay. And if the electrons in the valence shell get sufficient energy to break the force of attraction with the nucleus, and then they become free and enters into the conduction band. Okay. The range of energy possessed by the free electrons is called as the conduction band. And now we understood, in order to move the valence electrons from the valence band to the conduction band, they have to overcome some energy level. That's why they need some extra energy from outside. And this energy gap between the valence band and the conduction band, the energy gap between the valence band and conduction band, this gap is called as forbidden energy gap. Forbidden energy gap. Understood? Okay, so what is the energy band? When the concept of energy band came, when we consider the atoms inside the solid, where the atoms are closely and tightly packed. Okay, there the definite amount of energy cannot be obtained because of the influence of the neighboring atoms. Okay, so in such cases, the electrons possess a range of energy, and this range of energy possessed by the electrons in an atom inside a solid is called as the energy band. Then we know the range of energy possessed by the first shell electrons is called as the first energy band, that by the second shell electrons is called as the second energy band, and that by the valence shell electrons is called as the valence band. And sometimes the electrons in the valence band get sufficient energy to break the force of attraction provided by the nucleus. They become free, and now they are ready to conduct. And the range of energy possessed by these free electrons are called as the conduction bands. But for moving the electrons, valence shell electrons, from the valence band to conduction band, what happens? They have to overcome some energy level, and that energy gap between the valence band and conduction band is called as the forbidden energy gap. Clear? Now onwards, we represent the valence band as VB, the conduction band as CB, and the energy gap as EG. Forbidden energy gap, EG. Clear? Okay, understood. So the concept of energy band, whether it is understood to you? Yes, hoping you understood. Yes. And now, on the basis of this valence band, forbidden energy gap, and conduction band, we are going to classify the solids. Okay, on which basis? On the basis of VB, CB, and energy gap. valence band, conduction band, and energy gap. Solids are classified into three. Okay, you never draw this figure. This is not at all a correct figure. This is just a representation. I had taken that just for a representation to show that energy band. Okay, and now what we were talking about? We were talking that based on this valence band, conduction band, and forbidden energy gap. Okay, solids are classified into three. So, based on which quantity? Based on valence band, conduction band, and forbidden energy gap, solids are classified into three. Solids are classified into three. The first two types of solids are called as the conductors. The second type of solid are called as the insulators, and the third type are called as the semiconductors. Okay, so now we have classified the solids on the basis of our valence band, conduction band, and energy gap. Solids are classified as conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. Okay, what is the speciality of the valence band, conduction band, and energy gap of each? We are going to draw it. We are going to analyze it. Now we are going to draw the energy band like this, energy diagram like this. Suppose this is the energy gap, or this is the energy level, range of energy of the valence band. This is our valence band. And here the in certain solids called as conductors, the conduction band are so close to our valence band, like this, okay, like this. That is, even they are overlapping. The conduction band and the valence band are overlapping without forbidden energy gap. They have no energy gap. So what happens? Here Eg is equal to zero. Here energy gap is equal to zero. So what happens? Tell me. The electrons in, suppose there are certain electrons, a lot of electrons in the valence band. The electrons in the valence band can move to the conduction band at any time because they do not need any energy to overcome the energy gap because they have no energy gap. The electrons in the valence band can enter into the conduction band at any time, at any condition, at any temperature. So the conductors, this type of solids, always contains free electrons in the conduction band. They have free electrons in the conduction band, and they are always ready to conduct. And such materials which are always ready to conduct are called as the conductors. Okay, and the good example for conductors are metals. Example, metals. Solid conductors are metals. So what is the speciality of conductors? There the valence band and conduction band are overlapping without any energy gap. So what happens? Electrons in the valence band can enter into the conduction band at any time, at any condition. Okay, that is, there are always free electrons present in the conduction band. They are always ready to conduct. Okay, and such materials which are always ready to conduct are called as the conductors, and solid conductors are metals. Clear? Okay, and now we are going to second type of solid. Here also there is valence band. Suppose this is our valence band and there is conduction band. And what is the speciality of conduction band? Yes, there is valence band and conduction band, but they are separated with a large energy gap. The energy gap is greater than 3 electron volt. The gap, forbidden energy gap between the valence band and conduction band is greater than 3 electron volt. So what happens? The electrons in the valence band, valence band contains a large number of electrons, a lot of electrons, but none of the electrons will get sufficient energy to overcome this large gap and to reach the conduction band. None of the electrons will get such a large amount of energy. Okay, from external, we cannot provide such a large amount of energy so that they can move to the conduction band easily and become free electron and becomes ready to conduct. They never conduct free electrons in the conduction band. So hence, they never conduct. And such materials which never conduct are called as the insulators. Okay. And example for insulators, you know, silk, rubber, plastic, etc. Plastic, etc. Okay, clear. There will be no free electrons in the conduction band at any condition, at any temperature. Okay. Okay, and now we are going to the semiconductors. So that is insulators never conduct. And now we are going to the semiconductors. For semiconductors also, there is valence band with a lot of free electrons inside the valence band. Valence shell electrons are occupying in the valence band. A lot of free electrons are present inside the valence band. Yes, we know that. And there is conduction band, but the conduction band is arranged like this. What is the speciality? Here also energy gap is present, but the energy gap is less than 3 electron volt. Energy gap is less than 3 electron volt. Here energy gap was greater than up to 6 electron volt for diamond, 5.4 electron volt, up to 6 or 5.4 electron volt for diamond. They never conduct, but here the energy gap is less than 3 electron volt. Okay, so what happens? What happens? At low temperatures, the valence band electrons will not get energy to overcome this small energy gap. They never enters into the conduction band at low temperatures. But if we increase the temperature, what happens? Some of the electrons in the valence band, they get sufficient energy to overcome this small energy gap, and they reach on the conduction band and becomes free electron ready to conduct. That means if we further increase the temperature, more and more electrons will move from the valence band to the conduction band, more and more conductivity occurs. That is, at low temperatures, all of the electrons will be inside the valence band. But on increasing the temperature, electrons from the valence band can move to the conduction band, overcoming this small energy gap. Therefore, such materials act as insulator at low temperatures and as good conductors at high temperature. And such materials are called as the semiconductors. They are conducting semi, that is, partially they are conducting. Okay, it doesn't mean so. It means that the conductors or the materials which act as the conductors only at high temperatures and act as insulator at low temperatures are called as the semiconductors. Okay, and what is our chapter's name? Semiconductor and semiconductor device. That is, throughout this chapter, we have to discuss about this semiconductor. There are a lot of examples for semiconductors. At first, we are going to elemental semiconductors. Can you see the board? Elemental semiconductor. One second. Just looking on my camera. Yes, you can see it clearly. Elemental semiconductors. Okay. Silicon, germanium are elemental semiconductors. Okay. Then, inorganic semiconductors. A lot of semiconductor materials are there. Inorganic semiconductors, cadmium sulfide, gallium arsenide, then cadmium selenide, indium phosphide, etc. are inorganic semiconductors. Organic semiconductors, now we are going to the examples of organic semiconductors. Organic semiconductors are anthracene, doped, Thallocyanin, etc. Okay. And polymers, organic polymers are also there which act as semiconductors. For example, polypyrrole, polyethylene, etc. Polyethylene, etc. Okay, clear. So a lot of semiconductors are there. Elemental semiconductors, example silicon, germanium. Throughout this chapter, we have to take the elemental semiconductors only. Okay, we don't have to discuss about this topic. But this is given in NCERT, so you have to buy have the certain examples for inorganic cadmium sulfide, gallium arsenide, cadmium selenide, indium phosphide, then organic semiconductors, anthracene, dolphthalocyanin, then polymers, organic polymers, polyaniline, polypyrrole, polythiophene, etc. Okay, so these are. Okay, and all for all these materials, the energy gap is less than 3 electron volt. For example, for our silicon, it is energy gap is 1.1 electron volt energy gap. For germanium, it is only 0.7 electron volt. Okay, energy gap of silicon, we have to discuss about silicon and germanium in detail, not about these things. In this chapter, we have to discuss only about silicon, germanium. Elemental semiconductors. So the energy gap of silicon is only 1.1 electron volt and that of germanium is only 0.7 electron volt. So as the temperature increases, more and more electrons can overcome this small energy gap and enters into the conduction band, becomes free electron, ready to conduct, and they conduct. Okay, and such materials becomes semiconductors. Clear? Okay, take the notes. And one more thing, may I rub this? Okay, hoping you have taken the examples also. If not, go backward and take the example. Or it is also provided in your NCERT. And since these are different type of solids, based on their conductivity, they are different types of solids, we have to refer their resistivity and conductivity value. For conductors, the resistivity ranges from 10 raised to minus 2 to 10 raised to minus 8 ohm meter. Okay, for ohm meter, the unit of resistivity is ohm meter. For insulators, high resistivity, their conductivity is very poor. So the resistivity ranges from 10 raised to 11 to 10 raised to 19 ohm meter. Okay, and the value of resistivity of semiconductors lies in between these two. That is, resistivity ranges from 10 raised to minus 5 ohm meter to 10 raised to 6 ohm meter. If this is the resistivity, what about conductivity? The value of conductivity, if the reciprocal of resistivity is called as conductivity, so you have to take the reciprocal, 10 raised to 2 to 10 raised to 8 ohm inverse meter inverse. Ohm inverse is also called as Siemens. Yes. Okay. Capital S. And here the conductivity is 10 raised to very poor conductivity. 10 raised to minus 19 ohm inverse meter inverse. And here the conductivity increases with the temperature. So it ranges from 10 raised to 5 to 10 raised to minus 6 ohm inverse meter inverse. Okay, clear. So throughout this chapter, we have to discuss about the semiconductors. We have to discuss about the semiconductors. That is, this is just an introduction to the chapter. We have classified the solids on the basis of valence band, conduction band, and energy gap. Clear? Okay. And from the next lecture, we will go to study our semiconductors in detail. Clear? Okay, so hoping you understood what is energy band in solid, how the solids are classified into conductors, insulators and semiconductors based on the valence band and forbidden energy gap and conduction band, what are their resistivity and conductivity range, give examples for semiconductor, that is elemental semiconductor, organic, inorganic, organic polymers, etc., everything. Okay, the difference of the energy gap, here Eg is 0, here Eg is greater than 3 electron volt, here Eg is less than 3 electron volt. For silicon, Eg is only 1.1 electron volt, and for germanium, it is only 0.7 electron volt. Okay, so hoping you understood this much of topic very much. Everything is clear. Okay, and I am going to leave that lecture here, and in the next lecture, we will start the semiconductors in detail. Okay. Elemental semiconductor crystals. Okay. And once more, before leaving, this is our channel Physics Gallery. Asha Pino, see you in the next lecture.